Today I want to show you how I built a keyless access to my door using a keypad and RFID reader. You might have seen my teaser video where I open the door and receive a Telegram notification on my mobile. What do we need to build this? First, we need a microcontroller. The ESP8266 is one of the most popular devices when it comes to home automation these days. It has multiple I/O lines and complete Wi-Fi integration. It is small and it is cheap. The ESP8266 comes in various sizes and flavors, either as a naked SMD device, which you can make breadboard friendly using an adapter, or, and this is the preferred solution for beginners, the Wemos D1 or Wemos D1 Mini have an integrated USB port that makes it much easier to connect, power and program. Second, we need a reader. There are many possibilities. You could build one on your own, either with a keypad or an RFID reader, or you could have both in a ready-made device, such as the Gelicom devices I'm using at home. The advantage of these devices over other solutions, in my opinion, are that they have a stainless steel case, they can be used as a standalone device or as a reader, and in my opinion, they just look damn good. Many other readers are available in the commerce. For our project, it is just important that they support the vegan protocol, because this is what we will be using. Third, we need a relay board to power the door opening mechanism. You can use the relay boards that have been designed for the Arduino. They are not expensive and easily available. With a D1, you can wire everything on the fly using jumper cables. An alternative is to use a breadboard. Using a breadboard has advantages, such as using different voltages with step-up or step-down converters. And also, if you want to create a printed circuit board or PCB, you can test the circuit before you create the board. Last but not least, you need a door opener. This largely depends on your door installation. The one I use fits in the door frame and can be powered with 12 volts. It costs around 20 to 50 bucks on Amazon or eBay. Before we continue with the step-by-step guide, let's have a quick look what the result should look like in our lab environment. We want to type in a key code or use an RFID tag, and if the code is correct, the relay should spring for half a second or so. Now let's go step-by-step. First, we need the right flasher software. Let's use NodeMCU Pi flasher like we did in the last test motor video. In order to tell the hardware what to do, and who to open the door to, we need a software that can do all this. The software I am using is called ESP-RFID. ESP-RFID can manage multiple users, grant or deny access, and log events. It can also be integrated with your home automation using the MQTT protocol. Let's download and unzip it from the GitHub repository. Next step is to flash the software on the microcontroller. Wiring the Wemos for flashing is easy. All you have to do is plug it into the USB port of your PC, that's all. With the ESP on a breadboard, we need to do some more wiring. We need a reset button and a programming button on GPIO0. In order to launch the microcontroller in flashing or programming mode, these buttons need to be pressed in a certain sequence. First we press and hold the GPIO0 button. We then press and release the reset button. The microcontroller now starts in programming mode, and we can release the GPIO0 button. Just like we did in the last test motor video, we will tell Pi Flasher to automatically detect the device, we will wipe the data before flashing, and we use the baud rate of 115,200 baud. We browse for the generic bin file which we have downloaded and unzipped before. Clicking on Flash NodeMCU will launch the flashing process. The next step is to configure the ESP-RFID firmware. Like with test motor, the ESP has become a Wi-Fi access point, so what I need to do is scan for the ESP_something Wi-Fi and connect to it. While we are waiting for my Wi-Fi to connect, that might actually be a great moment to quickly hit that subscribe and bell button. Many thanks for doing this. Next, I can then connect to the 192.168.4.1 IP address, and the ESP-RFID config software page opens. This is where I can configure the hardware and Wi-Fi parameters, add the users and so on. ESP-RFID wants me to provide a password. The default password is admin, all in minor letters. First, let's specify the hardware parameters. We need to tell ESP-RFID a couple of things, such as the type of reader we are using, which is a Wigand reader in our case, the pins it is connected to, in our case this is pins 4 and 5, we can use or not the built-in LED as a Wi-Fi LED, and also we could use multiple relays, but we only have one and it will be connected to GPIO pin 13. Clicking on the yellow bar lets me verify the changes that have been made, and clicking on Save stores it into the ESP's memory. The controller has rebooted and I nearly forgot to tell it about my Wi-Fi. In normal times I want it to connect to my IoT Wi-Fi, so I put in the necessary parameters. After the reboot, the ESP-RFID reader is available in my normal Wi-Fi network. How did I find out its IP address? Well, I checked on my router to see if there was any recently connected devices. Now we can go ahead to the next step and wire the components. In the diagram, you can see that the relay is connected to the pin 12 of our microcontroller and that it powers the door opener with 12 volts. If you wanted to use a standard relay rather than a relay breakout board, you could simply use a bipolar transistor to power the relay. Don't forget the flyback diode. You remember the Tasmoda garden watering video with a valve? The same thing applies for relays. The Arduino relay boards have this on board already, so you don't have to worry. An easy way to translate 5V outputs to 3.3V logic and also to protect the microcontroller from high voltages is to just add a diode and a pull-up resistor. This way, the GPIO will always be on 3.3V level, except when the input goes low. Then it will go down to 0.7V, which should reliably be interpreted as a logical zero. An even better way of isolating the reader from the microcontroller would be to use an opto-isolator. This would protect from much higher voltages and also make it more difficult for a malicious attacker to trick the microcontroller into opening the door. I needed to make another adjustment for the relay board that I'm using in this video. The input is active low. That means the relay springs when the input is pulled to 0V. Unfortunately, the 5V module interpreted the 3.3V high level from the ESP as a zero level, so I had to add a voltage divider between the output and plus 5V to shift the level a little bit. Cool, now let's get to the last step and use ESP-RFID. The first thing you probably would want to do is add a user or some users. Let's click on users. You could create every user individually by clicking on the new user button. Or alternatively, you could just type a code or scan a tag while this page is open. If ESP-RFID detects that the code is put in or scanned that it does not know about, it will automatically bring up the Add New User dialog. Once we have added the user, he or she can now access the door using the code. Watch the green LED on the relay as I type in the code of the new user. I can check who accessed the door in the access log. But why does my log show the 1st of January 1970 for all entries? This is because my IoT network does not allow traffic out to the internet. So the ESP can't read the NTP pool NTP time server. I can, however, specify an internal NTP server on the NTP server settings. If you have watched my teaser video, you may have seen the Telegram integration. That means a notification on my mobile when someone accessed the door. In order to realize this, we need to integrate into some type of home automation system or server that can send Telegram or SMS text messages. The protocol we can use to communicate with that system is MQTT. All we have to do is specify the name or address of the MQTT server, optionally a username and password, and we are ready to go. But let's look into options for Telegram and or SMS text integration in another video. That concludes today's episode. Many thanks for watching. I hope you liked the video. Stay safe, stay healthy. Do not forget to subscribe. Bye for now.